I had to clear my throat a few times, you're just going to have to live with that. I don't know whether, you know, finding where the off button is in my pocket is probably not good. They lost the little clip that sits over here. You getting, I see you. I wanted to let you know that I have posted on my website. Let's see, do I turn this on and go forward? That website, some of you know, I posted the notes from Romans 5 through 8, where we've been studying. We'll finish up 8 and probably get into 9 today. So that website, theoutlet.us, you can find all the notes there up to the end of chapter 8. When I get through 9 through 11, I'll stick those up there and you can have access to those if that interests you. Chapter 8, verses 5 through 13, Paul says that Christians are according to the Spirit and in the Spirit, and thus are no longer obligated or obliged to live according to the dictates of the flesh. And that's important, and I love that. Okay, no longer trapped that way, but our rescue from the realm of the flesh hasn't removed us from contact with and influence from the flesh. So Paul warns them, and through them warns us, that if they fall back into a lifestyle of the flesh, if they fall back into living like non-Christians, they will die. He says, but if they continue to put to death the misdeeds of the body, by the power of the Spirit, they will have full spiritual life. And then in chapter 8, verses 14 to 17, he says that those who are doing that, who are mortifying the misdeeds of the flesh by the power of the Spirit, they have eschatological life, because those who are so led by the Spirit, they are sons of God. And life is inherent in being sons of God, because the children of God are the beneficiaries of the promises of God. And then when we ended, we were looking at chapter 8, verses 18 through 30. And I want to read that text again. I'll summarize quickly what Paul has said up through verse 25. Then we'll pick back up with verse 26 and carry on. He says, Romans 8, 18 to 30, "For I consider that the sufferings of the present time are not worthy compared to the glory that is going to be revealed in us. For the intense expectation of the creation eagerly awaits the revelation of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to frustration, not willingly, but on account of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will also be freed from the slavery of decay into the freedom of the glory of the children of God. For we know that all the creation groans and experiences," no hyphen there, "birth pains together until the present. And not only that, but even ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit, we ourselves also groan in ourselves while eagerly awaiting our adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. For in hope we were saved, but hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, through endurance we eagerly await it. And likewise the Spirit also helps in our weakness, for we do not know what is necessary for us to pray, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with unspoken groanings. And he who searches the hearts knows what the intent of the Spirit is, that he is interceding on behalf of saints in accordance with the will of God." I'll carry on. I'll read the whole thing. "And we know that all things work together for good for those who love God, those who are called according to his purpose. For whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed with the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. In whom he predestined, these he also called. In whom he called, these he also pronounced righteous. In whom he pronounced righteous, these he also glorified." Now I wanted to look back at the last paragraph here that begins, if I got this right, in verse 26. But first let me tell you how I see or summarize what I said about how Paul's, what he's saying up to verse 25. In chapter 8, verse 18, Paul says that what Christians suffer in this present life is insignificant compared to the glory that's going to be revealed in us. And then in verses 19 through 25, he explains that Christians and creation itself, that both of them are eagerly awaiting a culminating transformation that'll take place at Christ's return. Our mortal bodies will be redeemed and creation will be heavenized. That's a term I like. It will be transformed into the new heavens and new earth. And that is the hope in which we were saved, a hope that helps sustain us in the suffering. That he says our sufferings now aren't worth comparison. We are suffering now in this overlap of ages, and that hope that we have of redemption, of resurrection, of new heavens and new earth helps to sustain us in our suffering in this overlap of ages. As Paul said in Titus chapter 2, verse 13, Christians live expectantly awaiting the blessed hope, the appearance of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Well, I want to pick back up here in verse 26. In chapter 8, verse 26, he says that just as that hope that we have, that hope of eternity, that hope of new heavens and new earth, that hope of resurrection life there, just as that sustains us in this present world, helps us to endure in this time of this overlap of ages, so too the Spirit helps us in our weakness, helps us in our existence in this overlap of ages, in this time of infirmity, in this time of difficulty, in this time of suffering, in our suffering and longing to be free from the corruption and the infirmities of this that are part of life on this side of the consummation, we often don't know the things for which we should be praying. This is a fact. In suffering, we become acutely aware of how limited our perception is. Because, you know, when we're suffering, we think, look, if it were up to me, this wouldn't be happening. But God is allowing it. So when we're in difficulties and suffering, we become acutely aware of the limitations of our perspective, and this awareness that our desires don't necessarily match the will of God, that our desires may not be what God wants us to pray, that could have a chilling effect on our prayers. So that I recognize my limited perspective, particularly in difficulties and suffering, and I think, well then, what am I to pray for? Because it's hard for me to align with what God is doing. And you could then say, I'm hesitant to pray. But Paul says here that potential hindrance to our prayer is overcome by the Spirit's intercession. Now, this is the only place where Paul mentions that, but it's a neat promise. Neat thing, because it relieves anxiety. The Spirit Himself, he says, intercedes for us with unspoken groanings. Now, this is a metaphorical reference to the Spirit's ministry of intercession that takes place in our hearts in a manner that is imperceptible to us. That the Spirit has a ministry of intercession on our behalf that takes place in our hearts. He expresses intercessory petitions that perfectly match the will of God. Douglas Moo, in his commentary, he says, when we do not know what to pray for, yes, even when we pray for things that are not best for us, we need not despair, for we can depend on the Spirit's ministry of perfect intercession on our behalf. You see, so there, this idea of there being some kind of reluctance or restraint is relieved through this ministry of the Spirit. God, who sees into the inner being of people, who sees into the hearts of people where the indwelling Spirit's ministry of intercession takes place, He knows that the Spirit is interceding on our behalf in accordance with His will. And so the idea, it looks like we have Christ interceding for us in heaven, defending us from all charges that could be brought against us, and the Spirit interceding for us in our hearts throughout the difficulties and uncertainties of this life. So we have no anxiety when we pray. Prayer shouldn't be a source of anxiety, or I have to worry about that. You and I pour out our hearts to God, and if there are things that are out of kilter in our perception and the things that we're praying for, as Moose said, if we're praying even for the wrong things, we're at peace because there is this ministry of the indwelling Spirit, and He is interceding on our behalf. And God, who knows the inner being, knows the heart, knows the Spirit is interceding for us. So, I mean, like I say, this is the only place Paul mentions this ministry of the Spirit, but it is a source of comfort that we don't have to fret about it and don't have to fret in our praying, and I like that. Now, in this time of suffering and expectation, in this time before the consummation, in this time in which you and I live, this overlap of ages where the kingdom is a present reality, we have the down payment of the Spirit, these things are true, but we await the consummation. We live in this time of suffering and hardship and difficulty. We're also helped by knowledge of the fact that God in His providence works in and through all things. He works in and through all things to the ultimate good of Christians, described here as those who love God and are called according to His purpose. Paul, he explains that the knowledge that all things are being worked for the good of Christians is based on the fact God's purpose and plan is that Christians be glorified in the eternal state. You see, for whom he sits here and he says, we know that all things work together for good for those who love God, those who are called according, for, because, whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son. You see, we know this the fact that God is working through all things for our good, that knowledge is based on the fact that God's purpose and plan is that Christians be glorified in the eternal state where we will love and glorify God forever and be loved and blessed as His children. So we can know from that God is working in all things for our good. See, in this context, this comment that Christians are destined to be conformed to the likeness of His Son refers at least primarily to the fact our bodies will be transformed, that they will be like Jesus' glorious body. As Paul says in Philippians 3:21, as he says in 1 Corinthians 15:49, and just as we bore the image of the man of dust, so we will also bear the image of the heavenly man. This is shorthand for glorification. You see, so when he sits here and he says that death predestined to be conformed with the image of his Son, that is our destiny. That we will be glorified in resurrection bodies and spend eternity in the presence of God in a new heavens and new earth, a glorious realm. And Jesus will thus be the firstborn of many brothers, he'll be the firstborn of many brothers in the sense that he'll be the first of many to be raised from the dead in a glorified body. As Paul says in Colossians 1:18, Revelation chapter 1 verse 5, Jesus is referred to as what? The firstborn from the dead. The firstborn from the dead. In 1 Corinthians 15:20, he's referred to as the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep, meaning those who've died. You see, so when he speaks here of the first, he says that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. This is our destiny. Okay, so he says, look, we know that everything is working together, that God in everything is working together for the good of Christians, because we know that He has determined that we are going to be glorified. That is His intent and purpose, so we can know from that, since Christians are destined for heavenly glory, we know that our difficulties are not contrary to that purpose. God says, I have something in store for you. Here is where you're going. This is what I have in store for you. I have determined beforehand that this will be your state. So from that, we know that the other things that are happening in life, you see, because we're destined for heavenly glory, we know that the difficulties are not contrary to that purpose. In other words, God is not working against us, but He's working for our ultimate good because He has told us, this is what I have in store for you. This is what I am holding for you. However tempted we might be to think otherwise, given our inability to comprehend His immediate working, don't you experience in this world difficulty in saying, what is God doing? Am I the only one that has that? What is God doing in this particular situation? I've told you many times that friend of mine, Ron Burnett, whose wife, we were in graduate school of religion together, and Ron's wife, they had two small kids. She got an aggressive form of breast cancer, and she died in about 7 or 8 months. The day after his wife died, his mother died unexpectedly. And so this is just a situation. You're saying, well, you know, and Ron's line to me, his statement, he said, there are times when reason just doesn't reach far enough, by which he meant trying to figure out what God is doing in this circumstance, leaving me with two small children and my mother gone. And so you sit here, there are situations like that, you see, where it's difficult for us to understand and to see. But Paul says, listen, what I want you to know is that in all things, God is working for the good of Christians, because I want you to see what He's done, what He has determined, where He's taking you, and you can then reason from that or know from that. He says, look, this is, I'm for you. Do you see what I'm for you? This is what I've determined to do for you. So don't think that I'm working against you. I've already told you, this is what I'm doing for you. So even when you can't figure it out, even when you can't understand how is this related to my good, you trust that it is. Now that's hard. Okay, that's hard, and I know that. But Paul is saying, listen, God is working for good in all things. He's not working against us. He's working for our ultimate good, however we may think, when situations and things pull us to think otherwise. Let me paraphrase what Paul says in verses 29 and 30, the way I understand this. He said, look, those God knew in advance would become Christians. Right? God has foreknowledge. There are some who would deny that. But God knows things in advance. We say, well, how can He know the future if the future is open? Well, He's God. You see, He knows things in advance. So those God knew in advance, foreknew, would become Christians. Those He determined in advance would be glorified. He determined in advance, I see who's going to be Christians, who are going to be Christians, and I have something in store for them. I have determined in advance that they will be glorified, that they will be conformed to the image of my Son. Glorious resurrection. So He determined that in advance, and those He determined in advance would be glorified, Christians. These He also called to faith through the preaching of the gospel. You see it in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 14, Romans chapter 10, verse 17. That is how God calls people to faith. The gospel is presented to them. So God foreknew, saw in advance, those who will respond, who will become Christians, and He determines in advance that I've got something in store for them. I have glory in store for them. They will be glorified. They will be resurrected. They will live in eternity in that perfect realm. And so those that He called them in the gospel, and then He had determined it, and God's calling and our response, you see, it is simply the actualization of what He saw in advance would occur. It is the outworking of what He knew from the beginning, and those called to faith, they were pronounced righteous, right? I mean, isn't that what Paul has said throughout about believers? Who's righteous? Those who have faith in Christ. Those who say, yes, I trust Jesus. So you have God seeing from eternity who will be Christians. He determines from eternity what he's going to do for them. They are called through the preaching of the gospel, and as they respond in faith, they are justified, declared righteous, and those who've been pronounced righteous will be glorified in accordance with his prior determination to do that. He sees who will be Christians, determines he will glorify them, calls them to faith, justifies them, and will glorify them. That is our destiny. That is our destiny. And the glorification of believers that Paul has in mind, it is a future hope. He makes that clear in chapter 8, verse 18, where he says, "The glory that is going to be revealed in us." So this glory is a future hope. This glory is identified in verse 23 as our eagerly awaited adoption as sons, which he specifies means the redemption of our bodies. And he refers to this future glorification at the end of verse 30. In a Greek tense, it's aorist. It's typically translated past as a past tense. But he refers to it that way because God had already determined to do this for Christians. As we might put it, it's a done deal. It's a done deal, you see, and the certainty of it is highlighted by referring to it as if it already occurred. Now, it's also possible, but in this context, I think less likely, that Paul uses a past tense for glorified there, because our glorification that will be finalized at Christ's return in our resurrection is a process that has already begun. Right, as Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18, we who are being transformed. You see? So that's possible why he does it. But the glorification of which he's speaking is this state that he's talking about, this idea of being adopted as sons, the redemption of our bodies, the eternal state that God has in mind for us. And you see it, he sees us, he determines, he calls, he justifies, he glorifies. And that is us. You see, and I just think it's just absolutely breathtaking. Now we get to Lois's favorite section, of this, one of her favorite sections in all the Bible. And you can see why. In Romans 8, 31 to 39 says, "What then shall we say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not spare his own son, but handed him over on behalf of us all, how will he not also with him freely give us all things? Who will bring charges against the elect of God? God is the one who pronounces righteous. Who's the one who condemns? Christ Jesus is the one who died, and more than that, was raised up, who also is at the right hand of God, who also intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will affliction or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? Just as it is written, on account of you, we are being put to death all day long. We are considered as sheep for slaughter. But in all these things, we are completely, no hyphen, victorious, no hyphen, through him who loved us. But in all these things, we are completely victorious through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord." Now that'll preach. You see, this stuff here, this is good. If God has determined from the foundation of the world that the faithful will be with him forever in glory, whose opposition to us can matter? If God has made that determination, that the faithful will be with him forever in glory, whose opposition counts? What do I care? Any opposition is irrelevant. The God who gave his one and only Son on our behalf, as we might say, the God who pulled out all the stops. The God who gave his one and only Son on our behalf, certainly he will not withhold from us the glories of the eternal state. He's already given us his Son. How could you think he would withhold from us having given us this incredible gift? The most costly thing you can imagine. How could you think he would withhold from us the glories of the eternal state? His giving of his Son shows that he is all in to bless us. He's all in. He's done everything. He's just given to the max to bless us. So how could we think that he would withhold anything from us? He will not allow any opponent to thwart his intention freely to give eternal glory to the faithful. God will not allow any opponent to thwart his intent freely to give eternal glory to the faithful. No charge that is brought against any saint will stand up and thus exclude us from God's presence, because God, the one who counts, he has already declared us righteous in Christ. He's declared us that in him we are absolutely immune from condemnation. That's chapter 8, verse 1. There is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ. There is no condemnation. See, not because we deserve it, but because Christ has already taken it. He's already taken the condemnation. And so here, God has declared that. No charge will stick. No charge will stand and exclude us from God's presence, because he has declared us righteous in Christ. There is no condemnation in Christ. Not only did Jesus die and get raised to life for our justification, but he's in heaven. He is at God's right hand, presenting himself to God as our perpetual sacrifice. You see, acting in that sense of our high priest. He's there acting as our high priest, as John, the Apostle John, puts it so powerfully in 1 John chapter 2, verse 1. My little children, I write these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. You see, so now he's raised and he's there perpetually with his sacrifice on our behalf. What he has done for us, always there. We are always forgiven because of what he's done. Now nothing, this section here, nothing that Christians may experience in this life. Do you see what Paul's talking about? Affliction, distress, persecution, famine, nakedness, danger, sword. He's familiar with all of these things. And Paul says that nothing Christians may experience in this life, no amount of suffering that exists in this overlap of ages where we are saints, we have the down payment of the Spirit, the kingdom of heaven has invaded and is a reality, but as we live here and now, we still what? Suffer, persecution, all of these things, affliction, disease, death, all of these things. And he says, look, no amount, nothing that we experience, nothing that we experience will alter God's passionate commitment to our welfare, his love. Nothing will alter God's passionate commitment to our welfare, and therefore nothing we experience in this life will alter our eternal destiny. You see, we cannot be taken from God. Now, God leaves us free to apostatize if we choose to walk away from it, but nothing can take us from God. He will not allow it. It will not be a situation, as I've said many times, where on that day we've trusted in Jesus Christ, and on that day, oh, I'm sorry. I told you that I had determined this was what was in store for you, but some other power or force prevented me from delivering on that promise. That will not happen. You see, that absolutely will not happen. And nothing that we experience in this life, nothing will alter His love for us, His commitment to our welfare, and therefore nothing we experience will alter our eternal destiny. He's not going to change that and say, okay, I'm going to now work against you. And that's why we are completely victorious through all these difficulties. It is not because we are powerful in this life that we can prevent these things from happening. It is not that we don't experience affliction or distress or persecution or famine, unlike what people tell you on television. That, oh, if you're a Christian, you're in a bubble. You see, oh, no. You won't get sick. You won't have these difficulties. You won't have distress. You won't wind up crying. No. You're just going to float above life in this fallen world like that. That's not true. You will experience these things, but we are completely victorious over them, not because we are conquerors in that we prevent them from happening. Look, I'm the great warrior, and I can ward off any of these things and keep them from happening to me. Not victorious in that sense. You see, it's not that we don't experience hardships and death and these other things. What on the surface you see can appear to be defeats. That's what happened with Paul when Paul was in prison. In Philippians, people talking about, I think I can use his being imprisoned against him. Well, okay, stir up trouble for me by my chains. Well, what are you talking about? I can use the fact that he is in prison as an indication that God is not with him. You see, if God is with him, he would be going from triumph to triumph. He wouldn't be subject and be sitting in a jail cell. God is powerful. So you see this idea that people have. No, it's not in that sense that we're completely victorious, you see. We experience these things, which on the surface those things can appear to be defeats, but that those things, we're completely victorious because those things are unable to deny us what God has planned for us. That's the point. No distress, no suffering, no persecution, no famine, no going without, no danger, no sword. None of that can deprive us of what God has determined He's going to do for us. Do you see? I mean, so as you and I hold to Christ, what does this matter? It doesn't matter. We are completely victorious over these things. The faithful are completely victorious, not in the sense we stop the hardships, not in the sense we stop death from happening to us, but in the sense our destiny is secure despite their happening. And I don't know about you, but that to me is something. Because in this world, when you and I struggle and suffer, what can be greater than this? To say, I know this is hard, I know this is difficult, I know you're suffering, I know you question, like John, you know, sitting in the prison. Are you the one to come? Or should we expect someone else? Why is he saying that? We all know how John understood who Jesus is, but it is because the difficulties of this life can press on you and make you start thinking, well, did I miss something? Am I not understanding something? How can I still be sitting in a jail cell and have this clown be having power over me? Because the victory of God, that is not the sense in which we are completely victorious. We are victorious over these things in that those in Christ, our destiny is secure. You and I, as I've said many times, on that day are going to be hugging and laughing and enjoying each other, talking about the time we sat here, other places, Do you remember that? Oh, yeah, now here we are in this eternal state. You see, and that is secure because God is God. Because God is God. All right, chapters 9 through 11. A significant aspect of Paul's writing this letter is to unite Jewish and Gentile Christians in Rome around the truth of the gospel that he preaches so that they may, as one, support his mission to Spain. So that's a significant aspect of what he's doing. And in chapters 9 through 11, these three chapters go together. And in chapters 9 through 11, Paul addresses the issue posed by Israel's large-scale rejection of the gospel. If, as Paul's gospel declares, now if it's right that those who reject the gospel are under condemnation, then most Jews are under condemnation because most Jews reject the gospel. But if most Jews are under condemnation, then it seems either that God has gone back on his promise to bless the Jews, or something is wrong with Paul's gospel. Do you see the dilemma there? You say, listen, Paul, you preach the gospel. Those who don't accept the gospel, they're condemned. Most Jews haven't accepted the gospel. They've rejected the gospel, so most Jews are condemned. And wait, if most Jews are condemned, then God has either gone back on his promise to bless Israel, or there's got to be something wrong with what you're saying. So that's what Paul is addressing in Romans chapter 9 through 11. And he says in 9, 1 to 5, I speak the truth in Christ. I'm not lying. My conscience testifies with me in the Holy Spirit that the grief in me is great, an unceasing pain in my heart. For I would pray that I myself be accursed, cut off from the Christ, for the sake of my brothers, my relatives according to the flesh, who are Israelites. And if we can figure out where these hyphens are coming from, I'd really like that, because it just annoys me. Okay, I don't see them when I look at these things. All right, he says, for the sake of my brothers, my relatives according to the flesh, who are Israelites. Theirs is the adoption as sons, and the glory and the covenants and the giving of the law and the service and the promises. Theirs are the fathers. And from them is the Christ, according to the flesh, who is over all things, God blessed forever. Amen. Now, Paul stresses his sincerity. He stresses his sincerity and the truthfulness of his concern for Israel, probably because his position on the law and his position on Gentiles had earned him a reputation of being anti-Jewish. That's kind of comical, but that seems to be that he was accused and seen as being anti-Jewish, and he's certainly not anti-Jewish. Paul has great sorrow that so many of his fellow Jews are under condemnation. They're not receiving the blessings of the promise because they have refused to embrace the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is true that most Jews had rejected it. And so they're not receiving the blessings of the promise. And Paul loves the Jews so much that if it were permissible and efficacious for him to do it, for him to pray to be damned that they might be saved, he would pray such a prayer. Yikes. Now, if somebody's telling me, if somebody wants to convince me that they're committed to people and love them, that does it for me. That does it. He says, listen, I have such compassion and love for my people that if it were possible, if it were something permissible and efficacious to do, I would do it. I would do it. It is such a shame that so many Jews seem doomed to hell, Paul says, given the many privileges and promises granted to Israel by God in the Old Testament. I mean, just, you know, here, look at all the privileges and advantages that they had. Their adoption as sons. Israel as a nation had been set aside by God from other peoples. They'd been set aside for blessing and service. And God's adoption of Israel, it conveyed to the nation all the rights and privileges included within the old covenant. So here they had been chosen out, given these rights and privileges in this covenant with God. The privileges and promises include the glory. Israel was blessed with the splendor of the divine presence. He was with his people in a special way. So all of this makes it more agonizing that they are rejecting the promise and therefore condemned when they had all of these privileges and all of these advantages. And it's just heartbreaking. He says theirs is the covenants. Israel was party to or beneficiary of various covenants mentioned in the Old Testament. Abraham with the people of Israel at Mount Sinai. The covenant with David. Theirs were the covenants. Theirs was the giving of the law. God gave the law to Israel. Theirs was the service, meaning the temple service. The whole sacrificial and priestly system had been prescribed by God for Israel. That was theirs. Theirs were the promises of blessing given to Abraham, given to the other patriarchs. That was theirs. Theirs were the fathers, the great men of faith of Israel's history. And from them is the Christ. He's the one, he came from their line. From a strictly human perspective, the Messiah comes from the Israelites. The descendants of Abraham, the one through whom all the nations would be blessed. From them is the Christ. But of course, there's more to the Messiah's person than his physical descent from Israel. And though the punctuation and thus the meaning here is debatable at the end here, Paul is most likely referring here to Christ as God, as he does in a number of other places. But where he says, who is over all things, God blessed forever. Amen. But you have a number of places where that is. So Paul here discusses this and he says, look, he first sets out this idea dealing with this sense that Paul is somehow anti-Jewish. I'm looking at the clock here, making sure if the second bell didn't ring, did it? All right, good. I usually can hear it, but you know how that is. So he's saying, listen, that stuff about me being anti-Israel is complete nonsense. That's not the case at all. And then he says in 9:6-13, but it is by no means the case that the word of God has failed. You see, that's the issue. That's the tension. Well, if all the Jews, if most Jews, certainly not all, all right, I heard that. All right. We'll just pick back up here next week, Lord willing. Thank you.